When worlds collide, so far we've talked about North America, and we've talked about how that developed. Then we talked about Native Americans from when they arrived all the way to about 1500. Then we talked about Africans and what their cultures were like up to about 1500. And then finally, we talked about Europe around the year 1500 and what was going on there. We also talked about the three crises that was going on in Europe, the population rise, the new monarchies, the Protestant Reformation. So now it's finally time to just crash all three of those cultures together, the Africans, the Europeans, and the Native Americans, so they can finally become us. And this happens when the Spanish arrive in North America. The story actually begins with someone from Portugal. Portugal at one time was just sort of an independent kingdom, sort of very similar to the Spanish kingdom. And there was a guy named Henry. He was a prince, the son of the king of Portugal. He had a whole fleet of ships. And he began to sail down the west coast of Africa. Now, he's credited with discovering Africa. Notice I have quotes around that. Discovering Africa in 1441. The reason I have quotes around it is because, of course, Europeans already knew about Africa because it is literally right there. You can see this on the next slide. So again, here's the map of Europe in 1500. We've seen this before. And if you see at the bottom left-hand side, you see Portugal and Spain. And then you see, you know, kind of an unlabeled sort of mass of land. Well, that's Africa. In fact, if you look at the word Seville, in Spain, you can see where literally Africa and Spain almost touch. I've actually been to that one little spot, and you literally can see Africa from there on a clear day. So Henry the Navigator began to sail down the west coast of Africa and down off this map, and he just kept on sailing. Now, again, Europeans knew about that little bit of land there, but they thought that's all it is. That it's just, you know, some people there, then there seems to be a desert, and then nothing. What they didn't know was all the stuff they began to find. Those West African empires that we talked about the other day, and all their cities and their ports and their universities, and the stuff that they were collecting was considered unbelievable. They were getting gold and diamonds and jewelry and clothing and pottery and weird animals they've never seen before. And, of course, I have to mention, they also traded people. Later in this class, we're going to talk about the Atlantic slave trade that the United States was a part of. And we do credit or blame, if you will, Henry the Navigator for starting that as well. But for our purposes, Henry the Navigator begins what we kind of call this modern period of European colonization. In other words, the idea of sailing to different lands to trade, to make money, was this kind of brand new idea. And even though it doesn't really get started for another 50 years, Henry the Navigator was kind of the first one to kind of point the way to this. So when we talk about European colonization, we always start with this guy, Prince Henry, otherwise known as Henry the Navigator. But again, today we're talking about Spain. So again, here you got another map of Spain. You can see how close Africa is with Morocco and Algeria right below there. When you look at the map of Spain, and you just saw a map from the 1500s a second ago, you know, you can think of it as one country. But before the 1500s, what Spain really was a collection of small little kingdoms. And Portugal was just one of those kingdoms. It really wasn't a country in the way we think of it today. It was just a bunch of different peoples and different kingdoms, and they all just happened to speak Spanish. They didn't think of themselves as being Spanish necessarily. But that would quickly change. Now, we got to go back a little bit to understand what's going on with Spain. Now, the Spanish are a mix of Greeks and Romans and Italians and even Africans and native Spanish peoples. I mean, they're really a huge mix. But there's also a huge group of Muslims from Africa as well. In 711, Moors which is another word for African Muslims, invaded Spain. And in fact, invaded much of Europe. But in 711, they came into Spain. And for 700 years, there was an ongoing religious war in Spain between the native Christian Spanish and these Muslim overlords. And for much of that time, the Muslims were in charge. And by the way, you know, even though these were Muslims, and today a lot of people think of Muslim culture as being very violent, and you think of things like Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and admittedly, these guys were violent as well, but there actually was a lot of tolerance there. In other words, people who were Jewish, people who were Christian, were actually allowed to survive in Spain as long as they obeyed certain rules. So it is interesting to think about that for 700 years, Christians, which was the majority of Spanish people, the Christians are able to survive for this long without all being beheaded or all being killed or having to be converted or anything. But nonetheless, this is a 700-year war. It's called by the Spanish the Reconquista, in other words, the reconquering. Now imagine if you were Spanish, a Spanish Christian. There might be a moment during that 700-year war that you might start to wonder if maybe God isn't on your side. Maybe God is a Muslim God. I mean, this would be, for a Christian, a very depressing moment to go through. I think a lot of people don't realize how big of a role Muslims have played in European society over the years. Here's a map showing the influence, and it's not even a very complete map, showing the influence of these African Muslims played in Europe. You see here where they have gone into Spain and Portugal and taken it over, and even moved up into France. In fact, later, if you know, turn the clock past 711, you can see a huge swath of land that Muslims controlled, not only in Africa, but also throughout much of the Middle East and much of Eastern Europe. And today, for those of you who pay attention to the news, groups like ISIS, also called the Islamic State, this is what they're trying to do. They're trying to recreate this period. This is considered the heyday of Muslim control. This is called a caliphate. That's a Muslim empire. And that's what the Islamic State is trying to do. If you're wondering, like, why are they taking over these areas? This is what they're hoping to go back to, is this period where they control all of this land. But again, our focus today is just that little area of Spain. If you ever get a chance to go to Spain, I got to go to Spain in 2013 through the college. I got a little grant that they allowed me to go over to Spain and tour it for a week with some students. So I could do what I'm doing right now, talk about it in the class. And I was surprised when you especially get into southern Spain, how much of Spain looks like what I would consider to be the Middle East. You know, this, in other words, this huge Islamic influence. This is going into the town of Cordoba, a major city in southern Spain. And as you walk through this town, which is fully Spanish today, you go up to this mosque. You can see it there on your left, on the right there. And as you go into this ancient Muslim mosque that was built in the 11 and 1200s, confronted with what is very clearly Islamic or maybe even Middle Eastern looking architecture. And as you go into this mosque, and again, it's no longer a functioning mosque anymore. But as you go into this, you know, again, you can think, wow, this could be somewhere in Iraq or Afghanistan. And you just keep walking. And you keep walking. And then as you get in the middle, you start seeing these Christian symbols. What this actually is today is a Catholic cathedral built inside of a mosque, which is one of the only places in the world, I think, that this has happened. In other words, when the Spanish got rid of the Muslims at that time, they couldn't bring themselves to tear down this mosque because it was such an incredible architectural building that they decided to just use it. They said, well, we'll just convert this mosque into a Catholic cathedral. And what's interesting, we'll see kind of the same thing happen in the New World, where when they take over some of the Mayan and Aztec facilities, they'll kind of do the same thing. So again, you really get this striking sense of this clash of cultures between Spanish Christian culture and African Islamic culture in one building. But another town, I think historically more important for us, that you see the same thing, is in a town called Granada. That's what you see here. And Granada really has that African / Islamic influence. Now, here's another map of the Spanish kingdoms. And you see it looks like a rainbow, a layer of colors. In other words, you know, at one point, Muslims controlled all of this. But slowly, over time, the Spanish began to reconquer the Muslims, you know, reconquer Spain. And so by 1492, the last little area, I'm pointing, I know you can't see me, but the last little area is right there at the bottom where it says Granada, and you see sort of red. That was the last area that Muslims controlled. And that would be the last area that the Spanish take back to end this Reconquista. So in 1469, Queen Isabella of the Kingdom of Castile marries King Ferdinand of the Spanish Kingdom of Aragon. You might remember Aragon from Henry VIII. He married Catherine of Aragon, which was their daughter. But anyway, Queen Isabella marries Ferdinand. And by marrying each other, they unite Spain. In other words, this is what creates Spain today. The only kingdom they didn't control was Portugal, which is why today Portugal is a separate country. But all the other Spanish kingdoms, they controlled, and by getting married, they unite all of Spain. And they are the first new monarchy. And they are the most powerful monarchy in Europe for a long time. By the way, notice, whenever we talk about these guys, we always say Isabella first and then King Ferdinand. That's because she was the most powerful one. To be a little sexist for a moment, she wore the pants in the family. I don't know how many of you play chess, but the most powerful chess piece today is the queen. If you look at chess boards before 1500, there was no queen. It was all men. But around 1550, you start seeing the queen chess piece. The queen chess piece was based on Queen Isabella. Again, she was the one that made most of the decisions. She's going to make a very important decision in just a moment. So the last battle of this Reconquista, the 700-year religious war, took place in Granada at a place called La Habra. And this is today, if you get to go to Spain, it's actually a tourist attraction today. The Habra was the Red Fortress. It was this huge castle, this Muslim castle. And it was called that because the brick's a little red, and especially at sunset, it does have this reddish tint. Today, they actually shine red lights on it at night to really make it look red. But it is a beautiful facility. And it was a symbol of Islamic power in Spain. And again, it was the last stronghold of this Muslim world. Here, I got a few pictures of Alhambra if you haven't been there. Again, if you ever get a chance to go, I highly recommend it. And again, you can just kind of see the opulence of it. You can probably notice some of the Islamic artwork in some of these images. One thing about Muslims is that, again, that was a religion, a culture that developed in a desert. So obviously water is really important to Muslim society. It became a symbol for power. So wherever Muslims went, they always brought water with them. And they always had running water wherever they went. So whenever you go to these Muslim sites, you know, again, there's always pools and oases and running water everywhere you go. Again, it was literally a symbol of power. In the same way, for other peoples, a gold might be a symbol of power. Or nowadays, it would be nuclear weapons and factories would be a symbol of power. Romans did the exact same thing, by the way. So again, everywhere you look in Alhambra, you'll see all these, you know, presentations of water. The other thing you'll notice, if you notice the art, and this goes throughout the Islamic world, it is considered generally a sin to have representative art. Now here you do see, so it looks like some lions in the middle. That comes after the Muslims leave. That was done later. But in the Islamic world, and this is a local artist there at Hamra. In fact, I have a coaster I bought from this guy. It looks just like this, but it's really tiny. It's all symbols. It's all abstract. The idea of portraying God or Jesus or Muhammad or anybody was considered idolatry. Now, I've said that and students have kind of snickered, but you know, a lot of Christians used to feel the same way. We talked about the Protestant Reformation. People like John Calvin or John Knox, they did the exact same thing. They would tear down all the Catholic statues. They would tear down all the stained glass windows. They call that idolatry. So it actually isn't all that different from what a lot of Christians used to believe as well. So it is amazing art, but it is very abstract. The one thing they did allow was you could write the words of God or the words of Muhammad in Arabic on the walls. And that's what you see here. Anyway, back to history. Muhammad the 11th. Now, by the way, I was talking about the Prophet Muhammad, the founder of Islam a second ago. Muhammad is just a very common name in the Islamic world. So this guy actually has nothing to do with the Prophet Muhammad. Anyway, Muhammad the 11th was the ruler, the last ruler of Granada. And he lived out the Alhambra. And he was the one that was fighting Isabella and Ferdinand in this very last battle. And it was a futile battle. But he knew he was going to lose this at one point. So finally, this is a much later painting, but you got Muhammad there on the left. He meets with Ferdinand and Isabella there on the right. Alhambra is in the background. He says, look, you know, why are we still doing this? We should just, you know, I'm not going to win. Why slaughter everybody? Let's just stop this and I'll leave. And Ferdinand and Isabella agree to this. And in fact, ironically, you know, even though they fought the 700-year war, there was actually a lot of respect between these guys because they both fought very honorably. And Isabella and Ferdinand actually gave honors to Muhammad for doing this and paid him again. And they kind of saluted him as he left. And it was a very amicable peace that they came up with. But anyway, Muhammad and all his people had to leave. This is a very famous painting in Spain, and there's a lot of versions of this. This is called The Last Sigh of Muhammad. It's a story every school child in Spain learns. In the same way we learn about Lincoln growing up in a log cabin, or George Washington chopping down the cherry tree with his little axe, every school kid in Spain hears about The Last Sigh of Muhammad. What was supposed to have happened is that as Muhammad the 11th was leaving with all his people to go to the coast, to get on a boat, to go back to Africa, he stopped for a moment, and he turned around, and he sighed with a little tear in his eye. Because, you know, these guys have been here for 700 years. That is a long time. I mean, this is as much their country as anybody else's, and they're being kicked out. So he was taking a moment to reflect on this emotionally, reflect on this moment. And just then his mother, she's not in this painting, by the way, but his mother yells at him. She said, how dare you cry like a girl for something you couldn't defend as a man? You should be ashamed of yourself. You know, and dressed him down right in front of everybody. And he hung his head in shame and walked to the sea. Now, by the way, it's a great little story. In fact, the story has a lot of more elements to it, but it's not true. I mean, there was nobody there writing this down. I mean, you know, in other words, how did the Spanish knew this happened? It's just one of those myths that people tell, you know. But again, it's part of the folklore of Spain, so there you go. But for our purposes, what really matters is just that in 1492, which, of course, you know, that's a big year. We all know what happened that year. Now you know why 1492 is a big year. That was the end of the Muslim rule. The last of the Moors were expelled from Spain. Now, I just said a moment ago about how Jews and Christians were allowed to live in Spain for 700 years, just as long as they obeyed some rules. Notice this is, the Christians aren't doing, you know, I have to be careful here. I don't want to sound mean. These particular Spanish Christians are not behaving in the same way. To them, all Muslims have to go. Now, at first they said Muslims could convert, and they were called Moriscos if they converted to Christianity. But in 1503, even the Moriscos were kicked out or executed. And in 1493, all Jews lived in Spain. And there was a huge population of Jewish peoples in Spain. Even today, a lot of towns like Granada and Cordoba and Sevilla have areas called, it sounds very rude today, but that area is called Jew Town, which is an area of town that used to be the Jewish part of town. Those areas still exist, but there's no Jewish people living in those areas anymore. They were expelled as well. So this is a very strictly Christian country. By the way, real quick, I'm making Spain look terrible here. Today, 2015, there are Muslims living in Spain. There's Jewish people living in Spain. There are Protestant people living in Spain. It's a very tolerant society nowadays, but not in 1492, 1493. So think about this now. From a Spanish Christian viewpoint, you may have doubted whether God was on your side or not, but now there is no doubt. God is not only on your side, but he is a Catholic Christian God. And that sense of mission, that sense of confidence is going to really be ingrained in the Spanish when they come to the New World. But that's a really important thing to kind of keep in mind. This huge victory after 700 years, again, instills in them this huge amount of confidence. Now, one thing I want to talk about, again, about my trip in 2013 to Spain was, other than the architecture, I talked about how the architecture, you can still see the Islamic influence even today. Another aspect of Spanish culture that reflects this time period, which I thought was very interesting, was this what you see here. This is, by the way, some of the best food you ever eat if you ever go to Spain. Every meal, what you would see, breakfast, lunch, dinner, at a house, at a restaurant, doesn't matter, you would see something like this. You might have some bread, some olive oil, some slices of cheese, and then various types of ham or sausage or salami, which I love. It's funny because my wife went with me on this trip, and she can't stand ham. And she, by 3 days into the trip, we were there 10 days, she said, I am so bloody sick of ham. But I was in heaven. But it is interesting. Ham is everywhere there. They're absolutely fascinated by ham. There I am with another professor from Georgia Southern University. He runs a Madrid program there that I was a part of. And by the way, if you guys are interested, there is always programs to Madrid every year. And talk to me if you ever want to go. But here we are at a store that, again, sells nothing but ham. In fact, I'll buy some ham to take home with me. Here's another shot. And another photo. So why all this ham? Why are there ham everywhere? Well, you know, the Old Testament talks about certain rules for food that you're not allowed to eat. Now, Christians today say, well, we don't have to obey those rules anymore because there's a New Testament and a lot of that stuff doesn't matter anymore. But for people who are Jewish and they, you know, they follow a strict kosher diet, and for Muslims, if they follow the strict Muslim diet, one of the things they're not allowed to eat is pork. They can't eat pig meat. No ham, no sausage, no salami. So after 1492, it became tradition in Christian Spain that whatever meal you serve, you would always serve a little bit of ham, some sort of pig meat. And that, you know, you were basically saying, hi, I'm a Christian, and I can eat this. Do you want any? If you, like my poor wife, if she was living back then, she probably would have been executed because she would have been like, I don't like ham. They would have said, oh, she's Jewish. She's Muslim. She can't live here anymore. She's an infidel. She has to go. People even used to hang ham in front of their houses as a symbol of, you know. I mean, in other words, after 700 years, they couldn't get enough ham. So today it's just part of the culture. It's just part of how they eat. But it became an obsession after the Reconquista. So again, it does go back to this period. Anyway, just a weird little side note there. And if you like ham, go to Spain. All right, back to 1492. So on this spot, right here at the Alhambra, Here's a wider shot of it. You can see that little spot there is marked off with rope. Right there, Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand as well. But Queen Isabella gave permission to an Italian sailor that they would approve of his voyage to the New World. This Italian sailor has spent the last several years fighting in the Spanish army against the Muslims there at Granada. His reward was that, yes, indeed, they would support him. Of course, we know this guy as Christopher Columbus. And as you and I have been told since we were kids, is that Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492 to prove that the earth was not flat, but was actually round. We've always been told that everybody believed that the earth is flat, that if you sail too far in any way, you fall over the edge and some big monster eats you. I mean, you know, even in the Bible, it talks about the four corners of the earth. Although the Bible also talks about the earth being round, by the way, but nonetheless. So that's what we've always been told, and that's what Columbus did. He proved that the earth was actually round. And this, again, is always a big dramatic moment in movies and documentaries and textbooks. Here's another shot of an actor playing Columbus. You can see the map, and it shows you see the round part. Now, of course, you know what's coming. It's not true. It is a myth. It is the flat earth myth. It's just simply not true. Actually, everybody in 1492, at least anybody educated, knew the earth was round. I mean, they knew it from, they knew that ships often sail far out, then they go away, but then they come back. So they knew that they didn't fall off the earth. The Greeks knew about lunar eclipses and solar eclipses. In fact, the Greeks, using geometry and trigonometry, had figured out how big the earth was. In fact, nowadays, we know they were only a couple of miles off. I mean, they were almost exactly on it. Everybody knew the earth was round. Columbus was not unique in this. And that absolutely was not what Columbus was trying to prove. So why do we believe this? Where does this come from? It actually comes from us Americans. Columbus, when he dies in 1506, he's almost completely forgotten about. And we'll talk about why in a moment. He really is. It's like today, it's 2015. There are a lot of big rock stars in the 1990s and the early 2000s. But a lot of them, you and I can't name today. We've forgotten all about them. That was him. By the time he died, he was a has-been. There were other big, important people. And nobody cared about Columbus anymore. Again, until the 1800s. When we, the United States, started to write our history. And we were starting to write books. And like a lot of countries, we were kind of making some of it up sometimes. We were making the stories a little juicier, a little better. Now, in the 1800s, in the United States, we at that time were not the most tolerant country. I mean, heck, we didn't let women vote. We didn't let Native Americans become citizens until 1924. We had slavery. So we weren't the nicest country to everybody. And most Americans were white and Protestant. Americans didn't really like Catholics, and they didn't really like Spanish people, and they really didn't like Italian people. That would, of course, change later. So when the historians first started writing these books, you know, they had to go back, okay, we're the first people here. And you come upon Columbus, a Catholic Italian who sailed for Spain. Damn, that's the last person early American historians wanted to celebrate. But they had to, because he was it. Then this brilliant idea. What if we make Columbus smarter than everybody else? What if we make everybody else really dumb? But he is brilliant, because he's got this idea that the earth is actually round, where everybody else thinks it's flat. Suddenly, he's a guy that everybody can get behind. And so the myth is born. And of course, today, I mean, Columbus is huge. Before I get started. So who was the first one to really do this? Actually, it was Washington Irving. Some of you may know, the very famous writer. And also a pretty good historian, despite the fact that he sometimes made things up. You probably know him from the story of Ichabod Crane and the Headless Horseman. You know, movies like Sleepy Hollow was based on that. But he actually lived at the Alhambra. He was a caretaker, unbelievably. It was in ruins, and he was literally the caretaker. I mean, he just lived there for a while. And he was the only one there. And he wrote a biography of Columbus while he was there, a serious biography. But he juiced it up a little bit, and he literally just whole cloth made up the flat earth myth. And he even told people he made it up. It was like he said, yeah, I'm going to make this thing up, make it better. So Washington Irving is why we believe that today. And it's funny, it's still taught in schools today. So who was this Columbus guy, really? It's amazing how much of him we don't know. There's no painting of him that was done while he was alive. So we don't actually know what he looked like. He often wrote letters in a strange handwriting that only he knew. I mean, he was very secretive. He was born in a relatively low middle-class family in Genoa, Italy. This is a town that had lots of slavery. So he was around slaves. Now, these slaves were not from Africa, of course, but they were from the Middle East and Asia. So again, slavery was a huge tradition. We tend to think of slavery gone with the wind. But as you'll see later when we talk about slavery, slavery actually has a very long history. But Genoa was mostly known for sailing. Italy had the best sailors in Europe. And Columbus grew up as a sailor. He ended up marrying one of the daughters of one of the captains for Henry the Navigator. So he was pretty well connected, with the sailing tradition. And he did, as you'll see in a moment, he was a pretty good sailor. But Columbus, of course, today is huge, at least in this country. I mean, everybody knows Columbus today. Of course, our capital, Washington, D.C., is the District of Columbia. There's at least 40 communities named for Columbus, including two state capitals. Of course, in Florida, we have Columbia County. In Georgia, of course, you have Columbus, Georgia, and obviously you have Columbus State University. There's a national holiday, October 12th, that really nobody celebrates. We have a national holiday for the guy. But at the same time, there's also a lot of on the flip side, there's also a lot of anger at Columbus. There's a lot of blame. He's the guy who ruined the New World, that he slaughtered millions of Native Americans. And actually, he, as you'll see, in one of his voyages, he does do a lot of violence. Although his very first voyage, no violence at all. But that's really unfair. Yes, what's happened to Native Americans is very tragic, but you can't blame Columbus for all of that. There was a Native American activist named Russell Means, very famous in the 70s and 80s, who once said about Columbus that he made Hitler look like a juvenile delinquent, which is, of course, a ridiculous statement. So it's funny that one time Columbus was praised beyond belief, now he's sometimes blamed beyond belief. And of course, the reality in history is that there really aren't demons or angels, there's just people. And sometimes they do good things, and sometimes they do bad things. So, anyway, Columbus had this idea, not that the earth was round, but he had this idea of sailing to the Indies, which is Asia. Sailing to the Indies, instead of going east, say through the Mediterranean and through the Middle East, or going around Africa, which was huge, why don't we sail westward across the Atlantic and we can reach Asia that way? And he went to all these countries to try to get support, to get backing. Places like England and France and Portugal, the kingdoms of Germany, and they all turned them down. Now, again, when we were kids, we were told they turned them down because they were stupid and they didn't know any better and they should have. But actually, they rejected him because they had good science and they knew he was wrong. They said the earth is too big. And of course, if you can't take enough water, enough food to survive all the way to Asia. And they were absolutely right. What Columbus argued is he said, look, yes, I know the Greeks said the earth is this big, but actually it's about 20% smaller. He said the Greeks were wrong. I know they were wrong. And in a moment, I'm going to tell you why he thinks they were wrong. He said, it's actually only this big. Ironically, Columbus was wrong. Columbus was mistaken. He had the bad science. He was not the smart one here. But of course, what Columbus didn't know and what all these countries didn't know, but you and I know, is that the Americas were here. And the Americas are about where he thought Asia would be. So the Earth actually wasn't any smaller than he thought. It's just he didn't know about the Americas. So again, ironically, these countries were absolutely right to reject them based on what they knew at the time. The other reason they rejected him is because he also said, okay, when I get to Asia, I'm probably going to find some new islands. I'm going to conquer some lands. I want 10% of any of the riches I find. I also want to be called Admiral of the Ocean Sea, which is the title he made up. I mean, he just literally made it up. And he also wanted to be vice royalty of all conquered land. What that means is if you're sailing for a king, say the King of England, obviously the King of England's not actually going to go to this new land. So there's got to be somebody that represents the king in that new land. Basically, they're kind of like a substitute teacher, a substitute king. So he's basically wanted to be, not only does he want this incredible title and all this money, but he wants to be royalty. So these guys are like, what? You know, no way. But Spain, you know, Queen Isabella took a liking to him. Now, again, I used to be told that, you know, they had a romance. And there's even a silly movie that came out in 1992 that hints at this. Absolutely no validity to that. But she did, she liked his ideas. She probably agreed with his ideas. And she said, if you help us fight the Muslims, what the heck? We can make up a title for you. And, you know, if you find some stuff, hey, we get 90% of it. It's a pretty, you know, win-win for us. So they decided to back him. Now, he had to put up almost all his own money and do all his own stuff, but they gave him the validity, the seal of approval, you know. Because if he just does this on his own, that really doesn't do much. But by sailing for a country, again, that gives him street cred. So Isabella, and she is the one that made that decision. She said, absolutely, absolutely. And that's exactly what Columbus is going to do. So before I move on, why all this focus on the Indies, or also known as Asia? So why does everybody talk about this? Why is he so nuts and willing to undertake this incredibly dangerous journey to do this? And here's the answer. Spices, right? And then what we've always been told, and it's not wrong, but it's just not the full answer, but spices. And again, if you've ever had a chance to eat, for instance, at an Indian restaurant, and, you know, the smell, again, all the smells you might get in an Indian restaurant, all the taste, it really is quite incredible. Or if you've ever gone on a salt-free diet, or, you know, just taste food without any flavor, it really is awful. And, you know, we've already looked at the world in 1500 and know how empty that world really was. You know, it was not a very nice world. So the one thing you had, you know, was maybe some good food. And spices were considered that. I mean, some people describe them as the splinters of Eden, the little remnants left over from this garden of paradise. Now, sometimes you're told that spices were for preservation. Not really. Salt was done for that. But salt, they could get salt in Europe. I mean, it was, you know, you got to get it from Africa, you get it parts of England. It was a bit expensive. It wasn't cheap. You didn't use salt every day. But it was something you could get nearby. But not these spices. What these did, again, was just make your life a little more enjoyable. And it did sometimes cover up smells that, in other words, might cover up some smells of food that weren't preserved well. But here is, you know, where we get a little bit mistaken. Everybody talks about the spice trade. Well, it wasn't just spices, things that you use in food. Spices, the word spice actually really comes from the same word as specific or species. Like types of things or even money. Really what spices refers to is stuff. Again, the Indies, as they called it, or Asia, which, you know, runs from the Middle East all the way through Afghanistan and India and China and Japan and all the Pacific Islands. I mean, Asia is huge. And for Europe, that was the Walmart. Actually, I think a better analogy is Amazon. I mean, that's where all the stuff came from. Everything from gunpowder to paper to people. I mean, slaves, concubines, animals, skins, porcelain, which we still refer to as China today. Tea, which gets huge in places like France and England. I mean, all of this is coming from Asia. And it was very expensive, always has been expensive, partly because it's rare. Again, we talked about value a long time ago, what makes things valuable, because it's rare. A lot of this stuff was very hard to make. It comes from a long way away. Plus, you know, no matter what route you took, you can see there's kind of an oversea route or an overland route. Either way, there's lots of middle people you have to pay off, lots of fees and taxes and all that. So it's always very, very expensive anyway. But then, again, think about what's going on with things like the Reconquista, this battle between Christians and Muslims. A lot of this area is Muslim area. And those trade routes are being squeezed off, which is making this stuff even more expensive. Therefore, the spices are becoming almost unattainable by the late 1400s. So there is a huge demand for spice. Which is what's prompting Columbus go, hey, why don't we, instead of doing all this, why don't we sail to the west? In other words, sail, you know, to the left of this map and then come around on the right. You know, and we'll kind of cut out all these middle guys and we'll just deal with the guys directly. And again, on the surface, it's actually not a bad plan. Except for the fact that the Earth is giant and there's a big continent in the way. But he didn't know that at the time. So that's really what's going on here. That's the big deal. Now, I know you're thinking, why am I looking at a big, ugly fish? Well, there's another question here that I want to address very quickly. It's a very interesting study that was done a few years back by a few historians. You know, one of the questions that comes up is, why was Columbus so darn confident in all of this? Why does he think that he can do all of this? You know, why did... What is he just pulling this out of a hat? I mean, where is this coming from? Well, actually, historians think that it has to do with this fish, the cod. As in other words, this is what's leading Columbus to have all this confidence. Let me explain. One historian, and I stole this, one historian has referred to the cod as the fish that made America. Let me explain. By the way, a lot of you probably have eaten cod. You can get frozen cod, you know, at the grocery store. You know, a lot of fish sticks are made from cod. If you ever have fish and chips, even here in this country at Wendy's or at Captain D's or whatever, this is actually in London here. By the way, it's phenomenal. And I'm talking about cod today, but there's also fish like whiting and haddock and halibut that are very similar. Cod is a white-fleshed fish, and it is. If you like fish, it's actually very tasty. It's not very fishy tasting. I know that sounds funny, but it isn't. It's not an oily fish. Cods are huge. And these are small varieties of cod, by the way. But they are huge, especially back then. They were, you know, five times as big as this fish you see here. And again, lots of meat you can get from cod. They can be easily preserved. Cod are a very lazy fish. They could swim around with their mouths open and just sucking in water and eating microorganisms, which is why they're not oily. Fish that are very oily or very fishy tasting tend to be very active fish. Fish that are very sweet tasting and all that, they tend to be the lazy ones. Cod are the lazy ones. And that's good because that oiliness of fish is also what makes them rot and stink really bad. So in a world without refrigeration, how do you preserve fish, especially if you don't live on the coast? Well, you got to air dry it. You can smoke it. And here's some smoked cod. Looks like smoked mullet to me, but smoked cod here. You can, again, just simply air dry it by laying it out. And this is again still done in Northern Europe. And you can salt it. This is actually when I was in Spain. This is some salted cod, which is awful, by the way. You have to boil it for hours to get rid of the salt. But it can be preserved. Not all fish are prone to this. A mullet, by the way, which can be very fishy, is one you can do it with, but not as effectively as you can with cod. So why am I talking about cod for so long? Well, you know, in Europe, in the 1300s, and especially by the 1400s, there was a big trend, a ritual. Now, the Bible doesn't say you have to do this, but in Christian society in Europe, it became very trendy for Catholics, which was everybody at this point, to fast. This is where you don't eat for a day. You do this for special holidays, and you know you would do special times of the year. In fact, this is why. I'll come back to this. So you would, you know, nearly 100 days of the year, you were supposed to fast. I mean, that's a third of the year. But you know that wasn't necessarily realistic. So there were exceptions of, okay, you could eat the stuff you want to eat, but you are sometimes you can't eat anything. But other days you were allowed to do, you know, eat certain things. The most common day to fast was Friday. So again, that's out of those 100 days a year, 52 of those are Fridays because there's 52 weeks a year. So why did you have to fast on Friday? Because of this right here. You know, Friday was the day Jesus died. It's Good Friday. He suffered that day before being resurrected. So you as a good Christian, to remind yourself, to remember that sacrifice, every Friday you fast. Now, of course, what you were allowed to do was eat fish. You can have fish on Friday. And actually, there are still people today that do that. I mean, I know many Catholics that choose to still do that. They'll have fish on Fridays. And some families, it's just a tradition. It's just, they may not even remember why they do it. A lot of people eat fish on Fridays. I mean, it's an old tradition still. So you have people all over Europe, and many of them don't live anywhere near oceans, and they need fish, a lot of fish, because every Friday they got to eat fish. And cod is the best fish to preserve, which means there is a huge market for cod. By the way, this idea of fasting, we still see this today. Now, again, some of these days you really have to fast. For anybody in the class that's Catholic or Episcopalian, you may know why this woman has a black cross on her head. It's called Ash Wednesday. And this is the beginning of Lent, which is the time of you're supposed to give up something you love as a form of love of God and cleaning yourself. And I grew up a Baptist when I was a kid, and I didn't know anything about Ash Wednesday. And so I remember going to high school one time, and my teacher came to class, and he had this cross on his head, and I didn't know it. And I was a very shy kid, but for some reason I raised my hand and said, "Sir, you got some dirt on your forehead." And my friend elbowed me and said, "Shut up, man." And then I realized it was on purpose because it was Ash Wednesday. So you got Ash Wednesday, so you know you're not supposed to eat that day. And in fact, for a lot of times, not for a long time after that day. So the day before is the day you do a lot of eating. That was called Fat Tuesday. And of course, a lot of people know Mardi Gras in New Orleans. That's what Mardi Gras is. It's the build up to Ash Wednesday. So you have all these crazy parties all the way up to Tuesday. And then boom, Ash Wednesday. And so that's very common in European society to have this kind of Saturday night celebration before the very serious Sunday morning ceremony. Anyway, sorry, I'm getting off topic here. Back to fish. So where was most of this fish coming from? It was actually coming from Spain. And specifically, this area of Spain, in northern Spain, as you can see the map, down at the lower corner, you can see this colorful map. It's actually just a little tiny part of northern Spain. It's called the Basque area. And these were fishermen, and they provided most of the cod for all of Europe. They had a monopoly on it. Here's a map of the world. You can see all the blue area. That's where all the good cod fisheries were. So in northern Spain, these guys used to sail all over the UK islands and Scandinavia and Iceland and Greenland. And actually, even though it can't be absolutely proven, but there's some pretty good circumstantial evidence, maybe even all the way into Canada. The Vikings were definitely the first Europeans in North America, although at this point in 1400s, everybody's forgotten about that. But there's a very good chance that these cod fishermen did too. And guess what Columbus used to do? He used to sail with these guys. He was a cod fisherman for a while. He had all their maps, had all their secrets. So what he thought is that instead of, you know, he didn't know they went to a new continent. He assumed that they were in Asia. This is why Columbus is so confident that the Earth isn't as big as everybody says it is. Because he is thinking, these cod fishermen have already been to Asia, and they don't even know it yet. This is why he's so confident, which is ironic because he was completely wrong, it turns out. All right, enough going into the weeds. Let's get back to the real topic at hand. So finally, summer of 1492, Columbus gets three ships. He's got the main ship, Santa Maria, his ship. But he also has two other ships, the Nina and the Pinta, which are captained by these two brothers, the Pinzon brothers. And they sail from Spain across the Atlantic Ocean on their way to Asia, they think. Stop for a moment to think how big of a deal this actually is. Let's imagine that I went to you and said, look, I got this rocket ship in my backyard, and I can get us to Mars. Why don't you come over to my house and we'll get, you know, you'll get rich. We'll be rich. There's tons of gold on Mars. But get my rocket ship and sail to Mars. I bet most of you would not do it. And rightfully so. Think about these guys on these ships. This is, for them, this is like going to Mars. It's a very scary option, but they took their chance. So they're sailing and sailing and sailing. And they've about hit the point where they should be coming across Asia. And they haven't come across Asia yet. And there's a lot of doubt. Now, Columbus was a brilliant sailor. But he was a terrible leader of people. He really was a terrible leader. In fact, he was already jealous of the other two captains. He's already sure that the other two captains are going to just sail off and leave them behind at some point. Well, they know they're getting close to land. They've seen a branch with some green leaves on it floating by. They've seen some birds flying overhead. They've even found a carved stick, but no land yet. Columbus does have some gold with him for trading purposes. So one day he makes an announcement. This is probably about right now in late September. But anyway, he makes an announcement to the three ships. And if you're wondering, they literally used to just yell across the water. They would sail very closely and they could hear each other. And he basically said, hey, I have this bag of gold. First one to spot land gets the gold. Because when you're out on the ocean back then, it's easy to get turned around. And, you know, you're running out of water. You're running out of food. You know, one little island can be the difference between life and death. So it is extremely important for everybody to be looking out for land. And this is just a nice little incentive. Because he knows that these men are thinking about mutiny. They're thinking about, literally, about killing them, maybe, and throwing them overboard. You know, because, again, this is their lives in their hand. So everybody's looking for land. Everybody is. Days go by. Finally, one night, Columbus calls everybody to him. It's late at night. And by the way, today we think he was about 40 miles from land, and you cannot see that far on the ocean. But he thinks he sees fire. He says, look, fire. Nobody else sees it but him, but he swears it's there. Anyway, a couple of days later, October 12th, another sailor hollers, land ho, or whatever you would say in Spanish, tierra ho, whatever. And indeed, they found land. In fact, if you look at this map, up there at the very top, it says San Salvador. It would have been San Salvador that they would have found. And indeed, they found land. They were in what we now call the Caribbean. This gives you a little hint of Columbus. Do you think Columbus gave that sailor the bag of gold? Yeah, no, he didn't. He said, oh, that's great, but, you know, I already saw the land. I saw it a couple days ago. Remember when I saw the fire? Yeah, that was me. So I'm going to keep the gold. I mean, you would just think, I mean, Columbus is going to get all the glory. He would at least give the guy the gold. He doesn't. And that's a little hint into sort of the personality of Columbus. And it's one of the reasons why Columbus was completely forgotten about after he died until the United States came along. So they get the sense out of the door and they begin to sail around and they do see people and they're thrilled. And of course, they think they're in the Indies. They think they're near India, in fact. And so, of course, they call the people Los Indios, the Indians, which is why even today we still refer to Native Americans as Indians. It's a mistake on Columbus's part, which is why some people think we should say Native Americans instead of Indians. But as you'll see, even the term American has its own problems. You'll see that in a moment. For the record, if you care, and I'm somebody who does care, Indian or Native Americans are both legitimate terms. Of course, it's better to just refer to the people by their name, if you know their name, you know, Timucuans or Mayans or whatever, or Bob or Sally. But if you're just talking in general, it's okay to say Indians. But anyway, so no gold, no spices, no good stuff yet. But at least they have found land and they are saved. So again, this is just a tourist map, but you can kind of see the area we're talking about. You can see San Salvador just to the right, or excuse me, just to the left of that big white box. And then you can kind of see down to Cuba and what is now Haiti and Dominican Republic. That's the area they sailed. You can see where Central America, Mexico, and up above Florida is. He doesn't go anywhere in those areas. In fact, some people don't think Columbus will come over here four times altogether. And a lot of people don't think he ever even touched the continent of North or South America. We know he never came to North America. He probably did land on South America on his fourth voyage. But anyway, that's the area we're talking about today. The people he encountered were the Taínos. We don't really know that much about the Taínos today. Mostly what we know comes from archaeology and some of the Spanish records. It's estimated that in the Caribbean area, that there were probably about 1 million Taínos when Columbus arrived. You know, all together, all the islands put together. But within 50 years, they're going to all be gone. And next week we'll talk about why are they all gone? What happened to them? But again, we really don't know. We don't even know if they called themselves Taínos. And we don't even know if these were all the same peoples. We kind of lumped them all together today, but they may have been very different peoples. We don't know a lot about their language, although we do have some of their words. We do know that they were very similar to Mississippian peoples. They built mounds. They had male and female chiefs. You know, they were chiefdoms. They argued that they were sons and daughters of the sun. They grew corn, but where they originally came from was probably South America, and migrated to these islands. They also grew sweet potatoes and they grew pineapples and corn. So again, they were agricultural people. They did have a lot of words that we still use today, which is very, to me, I love words. So words like Savannah, which is in Georgia. Savannah, of course, the big city, the first capital of Georgia. Hurricane, canoe, hammock, and barbecue. Actually, the word was actually barbacoa, which is still a word used in the Spanish language. A barbacoa was a thing used to grill meat. And it's where we Americans get the term barbecue from. But the word that's most important is the word that's on the screen, tobacco. Of course, we use that word to describe a particular type of plant that you could chew or smoke. They didn't actually call the plant tobacco, but they did take that plant and roll it up into little tubes to smoke it, basically a cigarette. And those tubes they called tobacco. But over time, the word just became the word for the plant. Now, tobacco was grown in the Caribbean, but it was also grown throughout the Southeast. But Caribbean tobacco is a very specific type of tobacco, and it's going to be important later in this class. So just kind of log that away, that Taínos tobacco, because next week I'm going to refer to it again. So that is important. There's going to be by the way, Columbus is going to take the tobacco back with him. It's going to be pretty popular back home. But okay, so these guys are interesting. And by the way, we don't really know what they look like. There's a painting here based on archaeology and historical records. But by all accounts, they did run around naked for the most part. They're in a hot area. And for the Spanish, they enjoyed themselves in the same part of the world. I'll come back to that in a moment. But again, after a while, the newness is wearing off. You know, it's cool. Yes, they found this wonderful paradise with all these amazing foods. I mean, again, everything they're trying is stuff that you and I take for granted, papayas, and star fruit, and pineapples, and all this stuff. To the Spanish, they just can't believe what they're eating and the people they're meeting and the weather. And holy mackerel. But after a while, you know, they're ready to get back home. They're ready to find the gold. They're ready to start some trading. That's what they're here for. And that's not happening. So Columbus is happy that he's done initially what he set out to do. He found an easy route to Asia. Of course, you and I know he didn't actually find that, but he thinks he did. So he's almost satisfied, but he still would like to go ahead and, you know, clinch the deal. Because again, he gets 10% of any riches, so he needs some riches to find. He's also becoming very, very jealous of the other two captains, especially the captain of the Pinta. He thinks that that captain, he's very afraid that that guy is going to sail back to Spain first and get all the credit. So Columbus does something crazy. Columbus goes to the captain of the Pinta. He says, hey, do you mind sailing westward? There's that island of Cuba over there. Do you mind kind of just sailing around that island, maybe mapping it out a little bit for me and meet us back here? And where they were is today called Hispaniola. It's also known as Haiti and Dominican Republic. If you look at a map, you'll see where it is. It was on the previous map. So he says, we'll meet you here. Off sails the Pinta. Well, Columbus's plan was to take his ship to Santa Maria and the other ship, the Nina, with the brother of the other captain, unbelievably, they're going to sail back to Spain and leave the ship behind. That's the kind of guy Columbus was. That's how greedy he could be sometimes. But first, it's Christmas time. And being good European Catholics, you got to celebrate a holiday. So they're going to have a nice holiday. So there's huge celebration. Everyone's drinking and dancing. Columbus is having a lot to drink. So they're anchored just offshore of Hispaniola. But, you know, even when you're anchored, you still got to take care of the ship because it can still crash into the rocks. So Columbus is having a lot to drink. So he puts somebody else in command. Finally, it's literally a 13-year-old apprentice who's at the wheel of the ship. And slam. Early that morning, the ship rams into a coral reef, knocks a big hole in the Santa Maria. Now, these ships were built to withstand, you know, something like this. In other words, it's ruined, but it doesn't sink immediately. I mean, they are built so that they slowly sink. But the ship is ruined. None of these guys are shipbuilders. They don't have the supplies to rebuild their ship. But think about it. When Columbus wakes up the next morning with a huge hangover, he realizes, oh, my God. I got all these men, and I'm down to one ship. I've already sent one ship away. I've ruined the second ship. I only got one ship left. And Columbus literally just sits on the deck of his ship. And according to some records, you know, some accounts of this, he doesn't do anything for a couple hours. He is literally in shock. In the meantime, some Tainos in canoes, by the way, canoe, again, a Tainos word, some canoes come to the ship because they see them that morning. They see the ships and they're basically seeing, can they help? And of course, nobody speaks the same language, but through sign language and such, the Tainos are offering some help. And Columbus happens to notice that these Tainos happen to be wearing gold jewelry. This is something they're looking for. And Columbus, through sign language, you know, points at the gold and basically is like, do you have any more? They're like, absolutely, we got more. And Columbus, in a moment of political spin, if you will, he turns what was basically a stupid accident into godly providence. He literally begins to say, God destined my ship to crash in that coral reef so that we could find this gold. And that's what they do. he convinces Tynos to take everybody to shore. They dismantle the Santa Maria. They build a colony of La Navidad, which means Christmas town, named for the nearest holiday. And he asks for volunteers to stay behind. 39 sailors agree to do this. And we'll talk about why in just a second. And he's going to take the other ship, the Nina, and sail back to Spain. And basically he's like, I'll be right back. Be like, if I took you guys all to Mars, and I said, okay, stay here. I'll be right back. But these guys actually were kind of happy to stay behind. Again, the weather was great, great food. But a lot of this had to do with the people. Again, these guys are from a very strict Christian society where you have to fast every Friday. I've talked about this before. You get executed for all types of crimes, for profanity, blasphemy, masturbation, adultery. Here they are in a country that's very religious, but a different kind of religion. And they didn't have any hangups about, say, sex. In fact, it was very much a Tainan tradition to offer some TLC to visitors. So a lot of these guys, this was Vegas to them. So they were very happy to stay behind. And they do. Just before Columbus sails back on the Nina, guess what happens? The Pinta shows up. And it has to be one of the most awkward moments in history when the Pinta realizes that the Nina was about to leave them behind. So both ships sail back to Spain at the very same time, taking two different routes. And they both arrive back in Spain, oddly enough, literally on the same day. But of course, Columbus gets all the credit. He's got people with him because he's traded some of the chiefs for some of the people. In the meantime, by the way, Columbus is going to learn the language. He's got gold with him. He's got tobacco with him. He's got canoes with him. And Queen Isabella is thrilled. She's like, oh my gosh, he did it. Of course, everybody thinks he's been to Asia, not the New World yet. And she sends him back. She says, go back. So 1493, he comes back. This time he's got 12 ships, over 2,000 people. He's got carpenters, shipbuilders, priests, women, children. And he shows back up in summer of 1493, which again must have been a very, very awkward moment. It'd be like if somebody came to your house, knocked on the door and said, hello, I'm from Russia. I'd like to see typical American house. And you take the person in, you show them your house. He's okay, bye. And then 2 weeks later, they show up with a U-Haul truck. Hello, we're moving in. That's basically what these guys did. This was made especially awkward because it turns out the Tainos had destroyed La Navidad and killed all 39 people. And in fact, Columbus described seeing the rotting bodies still lying in the sand. Columbus will exact revenge for that. And he'll build a new colony, La Isabella. That doesn't last very long. Then he builds Santo Domingo, which is today part of the Dominican Republic, which is on the island of Hispaniola. And that still exists today. It is the oldest European city in the New World. And again, it's still functioning today, which is the beginning, again, of the Spanish New World. So ironically, that first voyage, no violence at all. But there was violence on the second voyage. So why did the Tainos kill the people of La Navidad? Well, at first, they denied any knowledge of it, but when they realized that Columbus could now speak the language, because he's brought Tainos with him, and they've learned each other's languages, he's got translators now, they do begin to tell the truth. And the Tainos claimed that the Spanish demanded 5 women each, or trouble would. And the Tainos said, well, that's it, we're going to take you out. Historians tend to believe this. Most Spanish and other Europeans did not behave like that. But we know to some degree, a lot of these explorers did behave drastically, horribly in the New World. Let me give you an example. On that first 1492 voyage, again, Columbus did indeed trade for 12 people to take back to Spain. And again, a lot of these Tainos chiefs were happy to give to people. That was almost a sign of power. I give you one of my people. And so one of these 12 people, some of these were women, And so Columbus had an Italian nobleman on the ship with him, a guy named Michele di Cuneo. And he kept a journal of that first trip. In fact, that's how we know a lot of what we know today. And he describes what he did with this Tainos woman. So I'm going to read an English translation of from his journal. Quote, "She being naked, according to their custom, I conceived the desire to take pleasure. I wanted to put my desire into execution, but she did not want it. And she treated me with fingernails in such a manner that you wouldn't believe it. So I took a rope and I thrashed her well. Eventually, she gave in." Unquote. He's describing a rape. So this is the first recorded sexual relation between a European and a Native American, and it was a rape. Now, again, there was a lot of, not to get too creepy, but there was a lot of consensual sexual relations going on that weren't rape before and after this. But this is the first historical account of one. And the guy is, when you read the account, he's not apologetic. He's just like, oh, I did this. Who cares? Big deal. And it does give you a sense of that some Europeans, not all, but some, maybe even didn't think of these people as real people, as people with souls. And that is, again, interesting. And, and it does give some validity to the Tainos claim. All right, I'm taking too long on this. So very quickly, Columbus ends up doing three more voyages. On his third voyage, he's actually going to get arrested for corruption. And I think I've already given you a sense that he was somewhat corrupt. On his last voyage, he wasn't even in charge. His son Diego was actually in charge. He was just along for the ride. So the only ones for Columbus, the only ones that really matter, are really those first two. Okay, so after 1492 and 1493, Columbus is a superstar back in Europe. And this now makes countries like France and England and Portugal furious. They're like, damn it, we should have supported that darn guy. Can't believe it. He did it. And so, for instance, England sends over a guy named John Cabot. Now, he actually was Italian. His name was like Giovanni Cabotti, but the English call him John Cabot, so he sounds English. Henry VII, the father of Henry VIII, sent him over. He sailed over to what is probably Canada, probably where the Vikings went. He sailed over there in one ship, came back. Only thing he had with him was a fishing trap. No gold, no silver. But Henry VII was like, all right, I'll send you back with three ships. See if we can find some better stuff. And John Cabot was never heard from again. They probably died at sea in a storm. But that's important. Because later, the English will claim North America. Because they'll say, look, we were there first. So what are the reasons you and I speak English today? It goes all the way back to John Cabot. But why are we called Americans? Well, that has to do with the other guy. Amerigo Vespucci, another Italian sailor who sailed for Spain. He sailed in 1499. He is the first Spanish to actually touch, if you will, South America. And he was also the first one to realize that this was not Asia. This was a new continent. In fact, Amerigo Vespucci will write a book called The New World, which is what we still call it today. He also stole some of Columbus's stories, because again, by the time he's sailing, Columbus is already in prison and already is starting to be forgotten about. So Amerigo Vespucci will also steal some of Columbus's stories and make them his own stories. Then, finally, in 1507, a German mapmaker named Martin Wadsemuller draws up literally the first map of the entire world. You see here, by the way, this map is gigantic. It's, in our classroom, it's bigger than one of the walls. A copy of this hangs in the U.S. Congress today. They literally paid over $1 million for it. And you can't see it on the scan, but you can see these little boxes in the maps. And if you were to read those, it explains why things are called what they're called. So you see Asia and you see Africa. But you can also see that little tiny strip on the left-hand side. That's the Americas. And in one of those boxes, he literally says, I call this land America after Amerigo Vespucci, the discoverer of the New World. So by now, 1507, Columbus is out of the picture. He's forgotten about. It is Amerigo Vespucci, which gets all the credit, which is why we're called Americans today, which is why I was saying earlier that, you know, saying Native American, in a way, that's also bad because that's based on another mistake. And it's also a name for an Italian explorer as well. So, anyway. There's also another explorer that's only been fairly recently discovered. Just a couple of years ago, another English explorer was discovered. This is a good example of how history is, you know, we're never done with history. William Weston was a name that nobody had heard of until 2010. You know, the story has always been that England didn't really care about the New World for like 100 years. You know, it wouldn't be until 1607 that you get Jamestown. And so the story has always been that John Cabot was it, and then they were done. But there was at least one other guy. Because in 2010, this letter on the right was a letter written by Henry VII. That's the guy there on the left. He wrote this letter to this guy named William Weston. And in this letter, he says, congratulations on your voyage to the New World. Here's some gold. Here is the things I promised you. And good luck on your second voyage. No one had ever heard of William Weston until that point. Now, for the last few years, people have been looking, are there any paintings of this guy? What happened to this guy? So again, the story of the discovery of the New World might be more complicated than we even realize, because again, people are just discovering these records. So who knows? That was just a quick aside. But again, for anybody who's thinking about history, but you might be thinking, it's all done. There's nothing left to discover. No, there's always cool stuff to discover. All right, so Columbus discovers the New World. And again, you put discover in quotes. You know, and he thought, you know, in 1508, Puerto Rico is conquered. 1511, Cuba, the biggest island in the Caribbean, is conquered. You know, England has sailed to the New World. Portugal has sailed to the New World. France has sent somebody to the New World. But nothing. I mean, a little bit of gold, some corn, a canoe, not much. In fact, Europe is starting to think that this is a bust. By now, Portugal has already begun sailing around Africa to Asia. They have already opened up the spice route. And so now, even though Columbus at first was seen as a genius, now 20 years later, 15 teens, people are like, well, that was dumb. What's the point? And so Spain was seen as kind of a joke. So people were giving up on the New World. So why, again, are we here? Why is what we speak in English? Why do we have all this colonization? Well, that has to do with Mexico. So I know it's been long, but you know, if you need to take a break, obviously just pause whenever you want and come back. But we got one last quick little section. We got to explain what happened in Central America, which is why we later will get things like St. Augustine and Jamestown and eventually the United States. So this is the last piece of that puzzle. So we've talked about Native Americans already. We've got to talk a little bit more about these pre-Columbian peoples, but those down in Central America, because they're the ones that play a big role. Again, this is just a quick overview. I don't care if you remember any of this or not. But, you know, you had Paleo-Indians and you had archaic peoples. But then you started getting these regional cultures. And in Central America, you get a group called the Olmecs. And they're known mostly for these big giant heads like the one you see here. They're also the start of the rumor that Africans might have come to the New World, which would be a cool story. There's just no evidence of it. But some people see these statues and they do look a little African. But some of them also look very Asian as well. But, and again, it's probably just purely coincidence. But the Olmecs were a pretty interesting society. And pretty complicated society. And then you get a group called the Toltecs, which built these huge pyramids. A lot of these still stand today. I mean, these things are giant. And of course, it's the Olmecs and the Toltecs that developed corn. what some people call maize, which is an Aztec word. And then, of course, from the Toltecs and Olmecs, the maize spreads throughout the Americas. But then, in what is now Mexico, you get a group called the Aztecs. Now, they didn't call themselves the Aztecs. The Aztecs was the name that their enemies called them. They might have been a-holes or SOBs, who knows. They called themselves the Mexica. In fact, the name Mexico means the land of the Mexica. They spoke a language called Nahuatl. They were Nahuas, is what they were. And they moved into Mexico from probably New Mexico or Arizona here in the U.S. And they developed an empire. This is a map of their main city, Tenochtitlan. Today it's known as Mexico City. But it was literally, initially, a city built in a swamp. And they had these huge causeways going out to it. I mean, it was an engineering feat. I mean, this was an amazing city. And this relatively small group of Aztecs, again, they called themselves Mexica, but I'm going to say Aztecs so it doesn't get complicated. This relatively small group of Aztecs eventually controlled an empire of over a million people. How did they do it? Well, they did it through religion, and they did it through violence. We talked earlier about the role of religion in empire. This is another example of that. Many Native Americans, including the Toltecs and Olmecs, worshiped many gods, including the sun god. But the Aztecs took that and changed it. And by the way, we have records of the Aztecs. There on the right are literally Aztec historical records. Aztecs began to argue that you should sacrifice people to the sun god. But you shouldn't just sacrifice anybody. You should sacrifice people that you have conquered in war. And so here's how it works. You take somebody, you put them on what this sacrificial block, you cut out their heart with an obsidian blade. And by holding up their heart and letting them bleed, that literally feeds the god, the sun god. And so in turn, the god gives you sunlight, lets you grow food, and you survive. So what happens if you don't sacrifice somebody? Literally, the world ends. Because what happens is, according to the Aztecs, every day the sun comes up, gives us sunlight, but then it goes down and it fights the night. And if it wins, it comes back for another day and it gets fed through sacrifice. But if it dies during the night, again, everything ends. So you have to continuously feed the sun through sacrifice. And again, the Aztecs said these have to be people conquered in war. I know it seems really weird, it seems awkward. Odd, but it's brilliant. And it's something Aztecs invented. I mean, we know they invented it. They even say it in the records, we invented it. It's a brilliant move. It's a horrible thing, obviously. I mean, there are records that they killed maybe as many as 20,000 people in a weekend. Think about the brilliance of this. It's constant war, and it perpetuates the growth of an empire. I mean, the Aztecs eventually control over a million people. But of course, those millions of people don't want to be part of the Aztec Empire. This is an awful empire to be part of. By the way, you look at that drawing there on the right. You can see, you know, again, an example of the horrible sacrifices they're doing. But if you look at the very bottom, you see somebody with a sword. It looks like a body part, and he's eating it. There is some evidence that the Aztecs actually practiced cannibalism. We don't really know why. We also don't know how much they did. Because cannibalism is actually very, very rare in the real world. It's in movies all the time. But in the real world, it's extremely rare. And most of the time when cannibalism happens, it happens for religious purposes. Some cultures might eat a little bit of a dead person so their spirit survives. In our culture, people used to do the blood brother thing. We don't do that anymore because of AIDS and things like that. But, you know, where you exchange blood. Even in Christianity, there is symbolic cannibalism. I always make somebody mad when I point this out, but it's true. It's called communion. I mean, think about it. Jesus says, you know, with the bread, says, here's my blood. Eat it, it becomes my flesh. Here's wine, drink it, it becomes my blood. And some people really believe in transubstantiation, which means that the bread actually becomes the flesh and the wine actually becomes blood, which is cannibalism. I mean, symbolic, but it is. But this is different. This is actually eating each other. And the Spanish claim that they eat each other a lot. But we do see some evidence of this. So the Aztecs. So imagine if you were Spanish, these people would almost seem satanic to you. Anyway, 1519, Hernan Cortes is on a journey to explore what is now known as Mexico. And he very quickly realizes the situation that there are lots of people under the control of the Aztecs, but those peoples don't want to be under the Aztecs. So Hernan Cortes, quote unquote, conquers the Aztecs. The reason I have that in quotes is this reason. The story has always been that Cortes and 200 soldiers rode into Tenochtitlan and over a 2-year period, literally took out the Aztecs, killed the leader Montezuma, and took over, conquered this million person empire. That's partly true, but it's leaving out part of the situation. Part of it is, you forget the Aztecs were catching all these European diseases. That played a big part here. But two, he does it with literally thousands of Indian rebels. So it wasn't just Cortes and 200 Spanish people. It was Cortes, 200 Spanish people, plus literally, not making this up, tens of thousands of Indian rebels. It was a real army. So, again, because this is the myth that says, you know, European is superior over Native Americans. You think, well, you know, look, 200 people took out a whole empire. Not quite true. And I also have the phrase decapitate a state here. What that means is if you're going to, let's say I'm going to conquer the college of Bainbridge College. I'm not going to conquer all 3,000 students. I mean, I couldn't even conquer a class of 30 students. You guys would all beat me up. I don't have to do that. All I got to do is get on my horse, take my sword, go to the admin building, go to President Carvajal's office, chop his head off, throw him out the window, sit in his seat, and I'm now the president of the college. In other words, you just have to decapitate the state. Take out the guy in charge, put yourself in charge, and you're done. And that's what Cortes did. He took out the leader and made himself the leader. And the Aztec Empire basically became the start of the Spanish Empire. And Mexico becomes known as New Spain. So that's one empire that's now Spanish. Then you got the Mayans. The Mayans were a little bit different. They also had these big pyramids. They also did sacrifices. But they weren't one big empire. They were actually a bunch of small little city-states. But again, we're talking over a million people. And they did have these very impressive pyramids. They played these very bloody ball games. They also had all these snakes everywhere, which, of course, if you're a Christian, snakes to you might equal the devil. So it looks like they worship the devil. So this has been seen as a very evil place to many Christians. The most famous of these pyramids is Chichen Itza, which is in Mexico. And it's, you know, a certain time of the year on the summer solstice, the shadows play right. And it does look like, you can see it there on the left, looks like a snake's coming down, you know, and tourists love to go to Chichen Itza. It's a cool place here we get to go. I've actually been. And when I went, you could still climb it. Now they don't let you climb it anymore. And you can see, you know, the Mayan world can be found in Guatemala and it can be found in Mexico. Belize, which is where this photo is taken, Honduras. I mean, there's a huge Mayan world. And what's interesting about the Mayans is they really capture their history through paintings. You can still go to these temples and see all these paintings. Here are some of the elite Mayan leaders. But if you notice what's going on in this particular temple at Benampak, which I actually went to when I was a student back in the 90s, you can see they got these ropes, and they look like they're running them through their lips. And on the right there, you can see somebody holding their lip, and they look like they got a big needle. It's actually a stingray needle. They're about to stab their lip with it. And here's somebody else. You got this big soldier, somebody kneeling. And again, they're running a rope through their lips, and these. The rope looks like it has a lot of sharp objects. The Mayans were like the Aztecs. They also believed in human sacrifice. If you've ever seen an Apocalypto, you see some of that. But they believed that the most valuable blood was the blood from leaders, from the kings. And the more painful that blood was to bleed out, the better it was. So what these kings would do, they wouldn't kill themselves, but they would purposely run these needles in their noses and their tongues and their lips and their genitals and between their toes. And the thought, I know it's very weird to you and I today, but the thought was as they bleed out, because they didn't die, that would make the gods even more powerful, which in turn made them more powerful. But of course, they also used slavery to build these empires. And they also killed many people by capturing slavery. And again, if you've seen Apocalypto, that movie, there's scenes in that movie that were literally based on this very painting right here. Well, in 1527, Francisco Montejo and his brothers and a lot of soldiers conquered the Mayans. And they did it the same way that Cortez did. In fact, they were imitating Cortez. It was disease, it was using rebels and decapitating the state. And the image you see here is Casa de Montejo. It's a big building in Merida, Mexico, which is on the Yucatan Peninsula. And it used to be a big Mayan temple that they tore down and then rebuilt in a Spanish form. And you can see the Montejo brothers standing there. If you look real closely, you can see the heads of the Mayans that they're standing on. They have literally conquered these guys. The last group is the Incas. Again, I'm almost done, I promise. The last group is the Incas, down a little further down in what is now Peru. This is Machu Picchu that you see here, which ironically, you know, I have this image. The Spanish never went to Machu Picchu. But you can see here that the orange, that's the Inca Empire. And like the Aztec, that this was a relatively small group. The Incas weren't very big. But they conquered all these other Native Americans that we might call the Andean peoples, Andeans for the Andes Mountains. And just like the Aztecs, they conquered these people by using violence and slavery and religion to conquer all. And so again, the same story. We have literally over a million people who don't want to be part of this empire. And all they're looking for is somebody to free them, if you will. And that somebody was Francisco Pizarro. He also had a couple of brothers. He also had a pretty big army. And in 1533, he shows up. And he does exactly what Cortez did. Except one thing that he did is that he captured the leader of the Incas, a guy named Atahualpa. He kidnapped him, held him in a room, and he told the Incas, he says, I will free this guy if you can fill this room up with gold. And this was a room about three times the size of our classroom. They didn't think they could actually do it. They filled it three times over. Think about how much gold that is. By the way, the Spanish killed Atahualpa anyway. But that story indicates why I'm telling you all of this. So you got the Mayan Empire, you got the Aztec Empire, you got the Inca Empire, and there are also others. There's a group that you probably never heard of called the Muisca, which were in Colombia. There are also a couple other smaller empires. So in Central South America, the Spanish are very slowly beginning to conquer these people. And this is why that matters. I mean, yes, they are also, and I'm not trying to be sarcastic here, they're also spreading the word of God in their own minds. That's literally what they're doing. By conquering these people, they're saving their souls. So this is to them a Christian endeavor. But this is why. Literally priceless works of art. I mean, again, unbelievable amounts of gold and silver the Spanish now control. And by the way, most of these would just be melted down into gold bricks or gold coins and sent back to Spain. This is suddenly, as I was saying earlier, 1492, Columbus discovers the New World. Everybody's like, yay, that's so cool. 20 years later, everybody's like, that sucks. Who cares? But in 1521, the Aztecs are conquered. 1527, Mayans are conquered. 1533, Incas are conquered. By 1535, this area is called New Spain, and it's the most richest part of the world, and Spain controls it. Everybody now wants to be Spain. France, England, Portugal, Germany, everybody wants to be Spain now. Now, suddenly, the New World matters. And of course, by the 1530s, the crisis of the 1500s are really starting to kick in. the Protestant Reformation, population rise, the new monarchies. There's also another impetus for people wanting to come to the New World. But this right here is the main reason. You can get really rich and powerful if you come to the New World. Very quickly, I just want to address something I've talked about before. We sometimes call these peoples prehistoric peoples, but, and I've already addressed it, in fact, that that's a bad term anyway. But with the Aztecs in particular, and the Mayans in particular, that's completely wrong, because they actually recorded their history. All over their buildings and their artifacts, not only do you see incredible drawings, but you actually see these hieroglyphs. These are Mayan hieroglyphs. Those are Mayan words. And today, at places like FSU, where I went to school, which is actually has some of the best Mayan scholars in the world, they can actually read those hieroglyphs. And if they read those, they can see that the buildings are dated. It tells you who built the buildings, why they were built, what the buildings were used for. And it also gives a history of the people. Today, historians, I can't do this, but historians can go through and they can tell you the leader of every Mayan city-state when that city-state was created until it was conquered by Montejo. I mean, we have that kind of history of the Mayans. A lot of people don't realize that. Mayans are, of course, still here today. Now, these are pictures of very traditional-looking Mayans. But actually, many of the immigrants that you meet today are Mayans. In fact, I've been to Walmart before, and I hear people talking. They're not speaking Spanish. They're speaking the Mayan language. People today throughout, Mexico and Guatemala stuff live in houses that still look like Mayan houses. They may have TVs inside and such, but there's, again, this perception that all the Indians are gone, the Aztecs are gone, the Mayans are gone. They're all still here. There's millions of these people still alive today. So, again, you start talking about being conquered. How conquered were they really? The Nahua, which we sometimes call Aztecs, they're still here today. You and I still use their words all the time. Words like cocoa and chocolate and tornado and tomato and tomato and tamales and all these tacos. These are all Aztec words that we still use on a regular basis. Anyway, I just wanted to talk about them. This is the main point, though. Aztecs, Incas, Mayans lead to incredible riches. Spain is the king of the world, and everybody wants to be Spain. All right, took longer than I thought, but there we are, end of lecture. When we meet in class again, we'll be talking about Spanish colonization, and we'll talk about English colonization. Thank you.